When it comes to architectural salvage, it doesn't get much better than a piece of this Victorian pier from Brighton. Drew Pritchard has been offered a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to buy some of it.
Yeah, I like those, they're good.
What's more, he's pretty sure he has a buyer lined up. But at the moment, tough negotiator Rachel Clark is standing between Drew and a good profit.
Over to you, really.
Well, unfortunately, for you, yeah. I can sell these very, very easily. It's a little bit tricky with Drew because, you know, basically he's a dealer, he's selling things on. I mean, I'd love to sell to him, but on the other hand, we are charity.
Can I buy the best pair I can find for 300?
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Deal?
Yeah, okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
All right, let's dig some of these out and find the best ones. Ideally, I want one from one side and one from the other side, so when we put them together, they become... two become one.
Not the biggest haul of his career, but Drew has managed to negotiate a deal for some historic pieces of salvage and hopefully found something else for his new client.
Thank you, Rachel. That was a
great
pleasure.
It's been a pleasure.
I'm sorry I couldn't buy more, but if I sell those quick, I'll be back for the rest.
Brilliant. Excellent. Really, you got really my contacts. Yeah.
A successful-ish day. I'd have loved to have filled the van, but I think our new French connection will be really happy with the things that we've found, and they're going to fit in exactly with his sort of building scheme for sure.
Back in Wales, Drew's wife Rebecca is struggling to organise the shipment of 7 tonnes of salvage to the south of France.
Or the logistics just might be a nightmare.
Drew's in Brighton buying, thoroughly enjoying himself, and I've got to organise a very large shipment to Saint-Tropez.
It's going to take the rest of the day and probably tomorrow morning.
Although used to shipping big items, the scale of the order is testing Rebecca's organisational skills to the limit.
How are we going to wrap these? Because otherwise their antlers will fall off, won't they?
We'll have to pallet crate them.
Yeah. Yes, because they're being forklift off the other end.
Yeah.
The biggest nightmare of a shipment of this size is packing. There's a lot of pressure. A lot of pressure between all of us. And if it fails, I'm probably the first in firing on this line.
Oblivious to the team's challenges, Drew and Julian are keen to find another location to make the Brighton trip worthwhile.
We have got... Well, it's an old cinema. It's the oldest cinema. I think she said it's the oldest cinema in Britain.
All right.
Old theatres and cinemas often have unusual pieces. Their research has turned up a place less than a mile from the pier, which has some film reels and memorabilia for sale.
We're heading to see a guy called John, who is the manager of a really old cinema called the Duke of York in Brighton.
The Duke of York Cinema was opened in September 1910, so it's just over 100 years old. It's a single-screen historic cinema. It's the country's oldest operating cinema. The cinema's still going strong, so I think we'll hopefully be here for another 100 years.
There's a room in there that they've not cleared out, and it's full of stuff. I haven't had a lot of cinema stuff. I've had God knows how many cinema seats and things like that. You know, the stuff I'm comfortable with, and then there's other stuff that I'll get where I'm like, well, I haven't handled it before, but I'll give it a go. The only way I'm going to learn about it is if I buy something. John?
Yes?
Hi, hi there. Drew. I've come about the film reels and memorabilia. You've got stuffed away.
Welcome. OK, shall we?
Love to. Have a look.
OK, yeah, come along. Yeah, that's where we make up the films, and this is the projection room where we show the films.
Cool. I've never been in one of these places before. This is where the little guy sits. I've always wondered what the view would be like from the little square box up here.
It's not the best seat in the house.
You can't see anything.
So I've got a pile of things here, a collection of different things that have survived the decades. We've got... What do they call those things they put on tires when you're sort of pimping your car out?
Spinners.
Yes.
How do I know that?
You could make these... You could put these on your SUV.
Yeah, we could put these on our transit van.
Yeah, they look
cool.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Pimp my van.
You can see that's quite.
Pardon mon affaire.
It's a trailer. French film.
Curzon Film Distributors.
That's probably about 30 years old.
Okay. You can see little bits in the bottom of it, can't you? Of the. It might be a French dirty film. It's a blue movie.
It's possible.
OK, we'll take that.
We do have a... five of those, please.
Yeah. Another cardboard cutouts. Do you have those?
Yeah, we've got a few of those, actually.
Oh, great, yeah, I'd love to see
those.
Just smells of old cinema, doesn't it?
That's because it is.
people don't really know what I want because I buy very unusual and odd things. So I always ask, is there anywhere else I can look?
We had these made for our anniversary. They kind of lived around the cinema for a while.
I know somebody would want that. So what are you doing with these? Are these to go?
Yeah, we could move those. We don't really have any use for them anymore, so...
Movie star cutouts like these are not rare, but can still sell for around £30 each.
If you want to take the whole lot,
yeah,
you do them for £30, all three of them.
Fine, yeah, we'll take those.
Yeah?
Yeah, for sure. I want him in the office. That's fab, isn't it? What a cool thing. Then all of a sudden, pop, you see this thing, and I just think, I've got to have that. It's great looking.
So this will have been probably one of the first speakers installed down this, during the sound era. You can see there, made in England. We believe that was probably one of the earliest speakers that was installed for the early talkies, as they used to call them.
The fact that this is from Britain's oldest continuously used cinema will add value. Drew is confident he could sell this piece for around £220, but can he get it at the right price?
Is this something you can let go now?
Yeah, I mean, it's just sitting up there,
yeah,
gathering dust. So should I say what I have in mind? And
yeah, sure, go ahead. You never know. If I fall over, you'll soon find out.
OK. Well, I'd say for something like this, £150.
It's really grimy.
Really make it. You can, you know, polish it.
I don't want to go too mad with it.
Yeah.
And my initial reaction was like, well, I really want that, but yeah, it's a bit too much.
Yeah.
I'd be happy to pay £100 for it.
Okay.
There will be some geeky guy who wants that for his collection. I bought it, somebody else will.
Obviously, I'm just going straight to this now.
Yeah, sure. I don't know what this... I mean, I know that this was used to tell people when the film was going to finish. So rather than a working clock, it would have just the, you know, it would say, film just, finishes at...
And it would just be set permanently.
Exactly, like... and you just set it, depending on when the film would finish, you set it.
Okay.
And the style of the numbers is... I
think this is probably 30s as well.
Clocks are always popular, and one with provenance like this could easily sell for £200 once restored.
What sort of price do you want to go for on that?
I'd say something like £50.
Somebody's messed about with the back of it, the insides are missing, it's got paint all over it. Some of the lettering is flaking away, so it needs work. Yeah, spot on.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I'd want to pay for it. So there, you're dead right there.
Right.
I wouldn't want to go any more than that. Somebody will love it. We won't make a fortune on it, but we'll certainly fix it.